Hello, hello, hello. Welcome to the official review of the media of the month. I didn't actually see that much this month because I spent 90% of it playing God of War. So let's just kick it off with the first item of the month.
Ho, 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 ho! Merry Christmas!
The Guardians of the Galaxy Holiday Special is honestly something I don't have too much to say about, besides that it's fun, you know? It knows what it wants to be, and it does it well. This isn't some massive big thing, there's not even a villain, it's just a nice little heartwarming special with my favorite actor right in time for the holidays, so boom, you got my vote. I'm giving it an 80 out of 100 on the official review, and it would go about here on the official MCU tier list. Glass Onion, A Knives Out Mystery. I mean, Knives Out was my favorite movie of 2019, and that was the same year we got Avengers Endgame, we got Joker, we got Ford v Ferrari, a ton of other movies, and even with that great year, my favorite movie was Knives Out. A really funny and clever whodunit, the twist was amazing, and I could go on and on. But then Netflix bought the next two sequels, I believe it was two sequels, maybe it was just this one, but I know they bought the rights to it, and I went, uh-oh. Because Netflix should never be able to touch anything good with like a 10-foot pole. They fuck up everything. I'm happy to say they didn't fuck up this. Glass Onion slaps. The acting, especially from Daniel Craig and Edward Norton, is amazing. But everyone slaps. I love Dave Bautista playing like a man's rights Twitch streamer. That was just amazing. The mystery here is really fun and clever like the first film. Although, you know, I shouldn't say no. That gets into too much spoilers. I'm not gonna say. It's clever. It's clever. And I hated the name Glass Onion at first, but after watching the movie, it works a lot better. These movies' heart and soul comes from Benoit Blanc, Daniel Craig's character. He's just so fucking good at this character. In the first movie and in this movie, he is the reason that these movies are as good as they are. You take him out, you don't have great movies anymore. It's just like a good movie, you know? The score is nice and works here. It's not like anything amazing worth talking too much about. The set pieces I love. The side characters all work here as well to make a great film. I would love to talk more about this film, but to talk more, I feel like I'd have to start getting into spoilers, which kinda would ruin a whodunit. So I'm just gonna stop here before I start getting into shit I don't wanna get into. So I'm gonna give this thing a 90 out of 100 on the official review scale. Black Panther Wakanda Forever. I'm gonna be straightforward. Black Panther 2 was kind of a letdown for me. I said it, boom, it's out there. I liked it. I just didn't love it, and I really wanted to love it. At first, I was skeptical, then the first trailer came out, and I was sold. It looked great. It had Ryan Coogler at the helm. I felt like everything was gonna work out, even though this film was obviously dealt a very awful hand with the sad passing of Chadwick Boseman, who played the role of T'Challa to perfection. To lose him so soon was upsetting, but nonetheless, the film is here, and the film is good. The positives of this film are great. The score is great. I don't think I have to tell you that. The characters and the world are both really good. I actually really liked Namor, even if he had a slightly weak motivation to be hell-bent on Wakanda being destroyed. Sure, he used to be one of my least favorite characters in the MCU. I thought she was annoying and way too smart, and while she is way too smart in this film, she isn't annoying. She steps up and can maintain the lead. The only character I wish was used more was M'Baku. He was really underutilized here, which is sad to see. I would have much rather seen Martin Freeman's side missions be cut from the film for more M'Baku. I also think the world of Talokan was really cool, even if not explored thoroughly. For a 2.5 or 2 hours and 40 minute movie, you should have been able to spend more time in like Talokan. The stuff that drags this movie down from a great movie to a good movie for me is obviously the big one, the runtime. This movie is way too long. You could cut out Martin Freeman's side plot, all of the Riri Williams stuff, and have a much more condensed story that would probably honestly work better. Riri Williams seemed way too forced into this movie, and honestly, she didn't work for me. I don't like derivative characters. Like, you have the Hulk, there's She-Hulk, you have Captain America, there's Captain Britain, you have Iron Man, you have Iron Heart. Like, come on, let's not. And Tony Stark was supposed to be the smart man who could build an Iron Man suit in a cave with a
box of scraps!
But now Riri Williams can too? It makes Iron Man seem less special when everyone can do what he did. She also is able to build this device that not even the top geniuses in the world could build in the film, but she built it in her dorm. Like, this college student built it in a dorm room with no access to resources. Like, really? They are making kids way too smart and important in the MCU, which is a little annoying because kids are stupid. I want less smart-ass kids that can go toe-to-toe with Tony Stark, Bruce Banner, the CIA. Like, it's annoying. I also remember there was like that meme when the first Black Panther came out. Oh, why don't they just give everyone a vibranium Iron Man suit? And that meme ain't a meme anymore. This is a mild spoiler, but in the film there is Riri Williams, obviously, everyone knows that, and two other characters that get literal Iron Man suits with the black background face and tech overlay scenes and everything. It's really annoying that they are turning every character into Iron Man. I thought the third act was dumb too. They have all these smart ass characters, but for some reason their brilliant attack plan was to attack the water people in the ocean. This is the same plan from the same genius that built an Iron Man suit out of a Dodge Charger. Pretty much to sum it up, the biggest problem is how much they tried to make this film big. They have it end phase 4, which it doesn't feel like an end to phase 4, but it is, and because of that, they had to introduce characters and plot lines for other films when they film, like this film really should have been more standalone. I'm feeling a 70 to 100 on the official review, and would go about here in the official MCU tier list. Oh my god. God of War Ragnarok is finally here. The end to Kratos' second saga, the Norse saga, and how is it?
Fuck! Dude! This fucking hate! Dude, fuck off! Just let me kill you!
That's right.
Fuck
dead.
You, bitch.
Perhaps we should check up on it.
It is fucking fantastic. Like most people, I absolutely loved God of War 2018. Everyone who played it did. Kratos and Atreus' journey to Jotunheim was one of the ages. This time, Kratos and Atreus journeyed through all the Nine Realms, and I loved every single second of it. To the point I got 100% of the trophies after just one playthrough, because I didn't want it to end. I wanted to spend as much time as I physically could. Let's start with the graphics. I mean, obviously the game looks phenomenal. Enough said. Now onto the story. We follow Kratos and Atreus 3 years after the first game. Fimbulwinter is here. The mega winter that leads to Ragnarok is upon Midgard. And even with Kratos' efforts to protect Atreus from war with Asgard, they are eventually pushed into action after an unexpected visit from a mysterious man, and it is glorious. The finale of this game is like Avengers Endgame on crack. It's so fucking cool. The story of the first game revolved around Kratos learning to love Atreus. This game revolves around Kratos learning to fully trust and respect Atreus as his own person, and it is just as emotional as the first game, with an ending that really just would bring a grown man to tears. And a story is only as good as its characters here. Luckily, the characters here are amazing. Kratos is complicated but hidden under a thick layer of badass. Atreus is curious for answers on his true identity. Mimir is Kratos and Atreus' guide through an unfamiliar land. Freya is in a state of hatred and uncertainty after Kratos killed her son in the last game to save her life. Brock and Sindri provide the comedic relief again here, while also stepping into some of their own character development and emotional moments too. Tyr is a god broken by torture, but the absolute standouts here are Thor and Odin. Thor being this man who has followed Odin as his right-hand man while also just wanting what's best for what's left of his family. And Odin is this man with infinite wisdom who is fueled by selfish needs and will do whatever it takes to achieve them. All of these different characters and elements lead to a cast here that is so intriguing because you can understand and you can see everyone's perspective, and it's only fueled more by the amazing real-life cast. Christopher Judge especially brings a whole new depth to Kratos that we've never seen, to the point where just seeing Kratos show emotion is emotional because it's been so earned after 5 mainline games now, and he is still the coolest fucking voice ever.
Death can have me when it earns me.
Danielle Bisuti as Freya, Adam J. Harrington as Sindri, Richard Schreiff as Odin, Ryan Hertz as Thor, Sonny Soljic as Atreus, and of course, Sungwon Chu, I think that's how you say it. I probably really fucked that up and I'm sorry, as Ratatoskr, the best damn squirrel related character in any video game.
You can help me with something and I'll teach you. You know, giant stuff. We're gonna get some food, plant some seeds.
Giant stuff.
I also just want to talk about the score, because I love the score for God of War 2018. And this score here, Bear McCreary just takes that score and bitch slaps it to create the most badass music ever for a video game. I also appreciate that Santa Monica Studios listened to feedback on the first game. The only two complaints that pretty much everyone had with the game were enemy variety. You would only ever fight like two mini bosses, either a different colored troll or a soul eater, and like 90% of normal enemies were draugrs. In this game, that is dealt with. There's more variety in the mini bosses and a lot more normal enemies that are all different from realm to realm. Svartalfheim has these poison spitting things, I forgot the name of. Alfheim has these elves, Vanaheim has plants, Midgard has raiders, etc. And the other problem with the first game was massive set pieces. It was a little smaller scale, not like mini. Stuff didn't feel like a threat to Kratos at all. After God of War 3, you know, it just wasn't as hype because God of War 3 was massive. This game, you know that when within 2 hours this happens.
About time.
I've been waiting for this.
You know my task.
The ghost of Sparta thing.
Yeah.
Then know what I'm capable of.
Show me. Now.
He ain't gonna be small scale. Just wait until that fucking ending. I cannot stop thinking about that ending. I also just have to shout out the side quests here. Most of these side quests in this game are more fleshed out than most AAA games from other studios, with a lot of emotion in some of them and some cool set pieces and scenes. If I had to nitpick for some problems here, the puzzles aren't great. Unless you've like never played a game before, you'll know exactly what you have to do. It's just a matter of doing it, which makes it seem more tedious than fun sometimes, especially since even if you get stuck for 0.2 seconds, your companions will immediately tell you what to do, which would be a bigger problem for me if the puzzles were actually fun, but they aren't, so I don't care if I'm told what to do, so I can get back to fighting some bitches. Another minor problem would be the compass. This thing fucking sucks. It's one of those compasses that leads you to the one area to then lead you to the another area, so you don't like get stuck. It doesn't just like tell you the direct path to go. The problem with this one is that the smallest input will fucking fly that compass around. Like, you could move your camera a nanometer and the compass will fling your waypoint 180 degrees, so then you turn around and it flips back the other way and has you just sitting there spinning in circles until you say fuck it and open the map and figure out where to go yourself. And when you are going for all collectibles and have to backtrack and go here and there and everywhere to get everything, the compass not working is pretty fucking annoying, but it doesn't ruin the game because eventually you will figure out just what you have to do, where you have to go yourself. To end it off with one more positive, it's nice to see a game without game-breaking bugs at launch. This is a nice polished game. Like, there's some mini ones I encountered, like the game letting me walk through rocks before I destroyed them, or some pop in here and there, but nothing like Cyberpunk or Warzone 2. This game is very polished, and that's nice to see. All this said, this game absolutely deserves and earned a 95 out of 100 on the official review. This thing slaps. Go play it. You probably already have, but if you haven't, you need to.